Don't you know that believers are meant to restrain evil? Look, there's a difference between repressing and restraining. They may appear the same based on what we experience, but they're not. When you repress something, you are pushing against something with force to harm something because you don't want a certain outcome. When you restrain something, you overrule and channel the thing that you don't want. But you're not focused on what you don't want, you're focused on what you do want. Let me give an example. Let's say there's a river, okay? And each half year the river overflows and there's a lot of water on the farms. You can fight this by putting sacks of sand around the river when the season comes that the overflow is coming. What will this do? It will hinder the river water from flowing on the farms, but the river water is still there. And here's the thing. It takes a lot of effort to drag all those sacks of sand, which are quite heavy, and put them in place. And once the season of overflowing is gone, you need to unpack again. So it takes a lot of effort. And truth being told, it's far more difficult dealing with those sacks of sand than it is to deal with the overflow of the river. What can you do? You can build a channel. I'm saying you can dig a channel or dig several channels and dig several big ponds. Now the river will flow to those channels, towards those ponds. So now each year, I'm saying twice a year, when the season of the overflow comes, you won't even notice the overflow because there's enough place where it can go to. What happens? You overruled the natural tendency of the river to overflow. You get what I'm saying? In the first example, you were fighting it, resisting it, going against it, because you willed against it. But your will against it was only short-lived. And next thing, your will against it brought more conflict on you, and it's more for you to deal with. Because now, each half year, you need to order sacks of sand, you need to have employees to put them over there, people to guard them. So now you have a whole baggage that you need to deal with just because you don't want that water to overflow. But if you realize, man, this overflow is there, you can't help it, but you can help how you deal with it. So let's deal with it in a proactive, beneficial manner. You see the attitude here? The first attitude is attitude of repression. The second attitude is an attitude of restraining. It's still there, but it's now channeled, it's now overruled, and it's now turned into something productive. Because so channels that have been dug, now you can build small harbors up there or small villages. So now there can be industry over there. So before, you only wanted to resist, you wanted to fight against something, but now you overrule something, which is far more effective, far more lasting than fighting against it. You get what I'm saying here? Restraint versus repress. The world represses its own violence with other violence. That's what they do, and it is effective, but it's still violence. We as believers, we overrule, and we can overrule because we have the power of the Holy Spirit. The world cannot overrule because they don't have the power of the Holy Spirit. They can be inspired by us and imitate us, but they still don't have the power of the Holy Spirit. We do. And look, why am I telling you this? It's because way too often believers still have this repressing mindset that they want to repress stuff that they don't want. It's good that there are certain things you don't want if those things are indeed evil. Don't just refuse things just because you will it. You want to feel the danger of you refusing something. That's darkness. There are things like sickness, violence, and poverty, all those things that you should refuse, that you shouldn't want. Even worldly people don't want them. But there's the thing. You don't just fight against something. You overrule it. You overcome it. You look beyond. For example, let's say there's a lot of crime in a town. And you look at the bigger picture, realize there are many broken homes here, many young men growing up in very oppressive households, and those young men don't have any emotional assistance, nor professional emotional help, so they become embittered, and this works out in all that violence. You don't approve the violence due to the painful background of those young men, but you realize it's happening. But you go to the root of it. You see there are a lot of broken homes. And you realize that in a short time, you, by your own effort, cannot restore all those families, all those relationships. But you realize something needs to be done. So what can you do? You walk by faith. You can propose a project with the municipality that you want to open a small business somewhere. And you want to hire some guys that are from the street, so they're off the street, so they won't be bothering people. If you say that, most likely the municipality would say, yes, do it. And when you do this, remember, you walk by faith. You don't just pick people from the street and work for you. You pray, and the Holy Spirit will begin to draw people to your business that will be employed over there. And while they're employed for you, they're now influenced by your anointing. They won't work for you for long, maybe for 6 months or something like that, but in that time, they've been influenced, they've been touched. And when they go away, that influence is going to affect the community. So now you have multiple young men throughout the town carrying the influence that you gave on that you transferred onto them from the Holy Spirit. And like an infection, this influence is going to spread around. So now you've overruled the crime problem in town by building an energetic network of positivity. There will still be violence there, but it's restrained. It's now hindered in its operation. And if there even is violence, it's overruled and trampled upon by the energetic network of positivity you enforced. You get what I'm saying? That's just one option. There are more options. But what I mean is, as a believer, you restrain evil. Not by your own understanding, but in line with Christ. And in his power, you operate and you restrain evil around you. I mean, didn't Christ say, I gave you power over the whole camp of the enemy to trample upon scorpions and serpents, and none shall by no means harm you? Didn't Christ told us that? Then isn't it time that believers believe what Christ said? Isn't it time that believers become hungry and desperate for what Christ means and how it works? I mean, would you rather have that you need to live a normal, restrained life, fear-based like the rest of the world, in a routine, just to not piss certain people off so nothing bad would happen? Would you rather have that, or would you rather just walk around freely in victory and no violence can harm you? Which do you rather have? Why aren't believers becoming more hungry, more desperate for what Christ meant with what he said, nothing shall by no means harm you? Oh, man. I'm telling you, you need to agree with Christ. Too many of you still agree with the world. I'm not talking about the superficial things, like that's what church often does. I mean, pagan church always make you focus on external stuff, superficial stuff. I'm talking about the deep-rooted stuff. If you want to overrule violence and trample upon violence and really make violence ineffective, then you need to exhaust violence around you so the violence will collapse itself while you remain standing. You need to think differently. Too many of you want to repress things. You think, okay, I may need to learn how to kick someone's ass, or I may need to carry a gun or knife with me just in case. You are into the repressing attitude. And the repressing attitude will work, but at your expense, and it is drawing you in violence also. And you're carrying violence with you because you're always alert, and you have a weapon with you, and anytime you can use the weapon, and it can happen, you're triggered and by thinking that there is danger, but while there's not, and now there's a situation. Don't agree with violence. Agree with the power that comes from the Holy Spirit, and you will overrule or overcome violence around you. There will be violence, but with you, it ain't going to happen. I speak from experience. I know what violence feels like. A lot of folks only think about violence when they see it happening, or on TV, or when they see it happening in real life, and they're shocked. I can feel violence from afar. I can feel that heavy energy, that hateful energy. Man, I can sense it from miles away. So when there's violence around, man, You can't fool me. And what do you think I'm going to do when I sense that violence? I'm going to cower away or just remove myself? If the Holy Spirit tells me that I should remove myself because the Holy Spirit doesn't want me to bother with that BS, I'll follow the Holy Spirit's lead, of course. But apart from the Holy Spirit's lead, I'm saying this, I'm in the Holy Spirit's lead always. Without direct instruction from the Holy Spirit, I do what I ought to do. I overrule it. I begin to speak against it. I begin to trample upon it. And I begin to send, and if it's something that's really coming after me, I send it back to its sender. Hey, listen. As a believer, you restrain evil. You don't repress evil like people in the world do by repaying evil for evil. You restrain evil. This doesn't mean that you are Christ, you're not Christ, but you follow Christ, you operate in his power. How come Christ said, none shall by no means harm you? I gave you power to trample upon scorpions and serpents and upon the whole camp of the enemy. That means all psychic attacks. That means the violence in the world, the kidnappers in the world, the criminal gangs in the world, the prostitution gangs in the world, the warlock cabinets, the shadow government. The whole camp of the enemy, Christ said. So how can it be that our believers who claim to follow Christ, but they're living in fear? They're living in all kinds of worldly restraints. Some believers, they don't even dare to smile often because some people may get offended. Some people may get feelings may be hurt because they're smiling a lot. Because if they smile a lot, people come to ask them why they're smiling. So I don't need to explain why they're smiling. So don't even dare to express joy because some people are going to be upset. Hey, I'm a bit embarrassed by that situation. That believers put up with this. And this, here's why believers put up with this, because they were misinformed by pagan churches. Pagan churches make you into perfect, easy victims. Pagan churches turn you into someone that enables evil and enables predators by either absorbing all the violence and perishing, or by running away and enabling others to fight evil with evil. That's what pagan churches make you into. Pagan churches don't tell you how to overrule and overcome. They don't. Listen, it's a long time ago. I was 14 back then. And there was this mayor of a Dutch city that said that there are many churches in this city, a lot of them, but they don't work. Back then, I was still confused, thinking that pagan Christianity is the original one. I still thought that those institutions of pagan Christianity were legit. I was deceived then, even though I sensed something was wrong. So when this mayor said this, I was upset. Then a pagan Christian who deceived himself told me, he's telling the truth, they don't work. And I began to think, and I realized, hold on a minute, it's true. If you have all those buildings where people so-called praise the Lord every Sunday, and people claim they have the power of the Holy Spirit, how come that you have so many in a city and the violence continues? Whether it's domestic violence, sexual violence, violence against children. I mean, also people with psychological issues that end up killing themselves and all of that. If you have so many points of power in a city that claim to get power from Christ, then they should have turned that city upside down. They should have turned that city around a long time ago. Not that F1 would have become a believer, but it should have challenged evil and challenged violence so much that violence is now fleeing from them wherever they are. There will still be violence, but violence will be so restrained because believers are walking around and everywhere they go, darkness becomes terrified. Darkness begins to flee. Everywhere a believer, when a believer enters a storm, people with anger in them feel threatened, so they cower and walk away from the store because the believer is there. It can be, for example, that there was this young lady there and she was about to be sexually assaulted. But here this believer walks by, doesn't even know the situation, but that sex offender senses that something is coming after him, and he looks around and he sees the believer. but he doesn't see any weapon or anything with the believer, but he feels so threatened, and he thinks, you know what, I'm out of here. And the girl is left alone. Such things ought to be natural when you have many believers in a place. It's not natural when you have many believers in a place and violence just has its easy course. That shouldn't be. And you know what? It's what that mayor, whom I know now was a Freemason. Nevertheless, I'm not going into that subject of Freemasonry now, but it's that mayor, it's that comment he made that indirectly led me to question more things. And it's that I realized that pagan Christianity is pagan Christianity. That's why I call it pagan Christianity. Because I realized, hold on a minute, how can it be that these people follow the testimony of Christ? How can they follow the New Testament in which so much provision and power is secured unto them? How can they claim to follow Christ who gave them all the security, yet they don't walk in the security? I mean, that confused me even more. But this was the Holy Spirit delivering me from pagan Christianity. And now I'm testifying to you today. This video was not about pagan Christianity, but I mentioned this at the end of this video. Pagan Christianity is very dangerous. Instead of dealing with violence by advancing the kingdom of Christ in the world, reaching people, they're reaching people with a fake gospel, with a fake solution, which will only relocate the violence. That's what pagan Christianity does. It relocates the violence. And because the violence is relocated, now have spots of relief. And they're going to use these spots of relief as kind of evidence that their fake gospel is working. It's all propaganda. I'm telling you. Agree with Christ. Be at peace.